morning, everyone. We have a warm welcome this morning to our meeting in this wet July. It's been the wettest July, hasn't it, apparently, on record for some time. But I saw something funny on Facebook, which I posted on. It showed this man having a glass of wine in Holland. He'd been camping, he was sat at a table drinking a glass of wine and having some soup, and the rain was pouring down upon him while he was enjoying the weather. But it has been wet, but thankfully we're nice and dry in here, and we're sorry, of course, for those that have gone on holiday. It's a shame when you go on holiday and you get wet weather. So we pray for those on holiday as well, that the weather won't stop them enjoying themselves. I'm just going to read just a small portion of scripture before I'm going to say hand over to the music group, but the music group's not here this morning because Diane understands not too well. But the guys will be putting some choruses up from past services that we can sing instead. So after I've read this passage, I'll hand over to Les to play some choruses for it. Isaiah 40, I'll be referring to this passage later in my message. The prophet there says, "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, and that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the desert, 'Prepare for the way for the Lord, make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God.' Every valley shall be raised up, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The rough ground shall become level, and the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind will see it, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it." That is the word of the Lord. I'll now hand over to Les to put some choruses up for us. If you wish to stand to sing them, please do so.
Yeah. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to Him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to Him. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus from behind. Jesus said, if I am lost, He will come to me, and He showed me on that cross, He will come to me. For the Lord is good and faithful, He will keep us day and night. We can always come to Jesus.
when my time has come, I'll praise God, unending, was written by John Wesley, that part of that song. That those hymns were written at the height of a great spiritual revival in this country through the ministry of men like John Wesley and George Whitfield. And thousands upon thousands of people came to Christ through the dedicated ministry of those great, great men of God. And they left us a wonderful legacy in the hymns that we sing so frequently. And can it be that I should give hymns like that, that are evergreen to the Christian church? And we're here this morning, first and foremost, that we might worship God, that we might give to him the love, the adoration that we so much owe him. And so we'll now come and have our family prayer. Let's pray together, shall we? So our gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we are here in this place by your grace, by your love, and by your mercy. We come to you today, Lord, because you first loved us. We didn't love you, but you loved us. And we thank you, Father, this morning, Lord, for that eternal love, that unconditional love, that love which knows no bounds. And we pray this morning, Lord, that we might be able, through your Holy Spirit, to lay hold on these things, that we might know, each of us this morning here, in our individual lives, that reality of your love. As I say, a love which is unconditional, which has never been earned or could have been earned, but you've given it to us by your grace. And we thank you, Lord, indeed, for reminding us in your word that this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Jesus Christ came into this world to save sinners. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. Came to pour out his life as an offering for sin, that we might receive the fullness of joy and the reward of everlasting life. And so, Lord, we worship you above all that's in our lives. We know that without you, we have nothing at all. If we do not have you, we have no breath in our body. We have no daily sustenance of our food, our clothes, and our shelter, because everything that we have in this world, however much or however little we may have, comes to us from your divine hand. And Lord, when we look around our world at this time, we see a world torn apart in so many areas. In 26 areas of this world, today, at this moment, there is conflict and war. We're not experiencing it here, but there are so many places where children are dying through starvation, loss of their parents, not knowing where the next meal is coming from. We think of the people in Ukraine particularly that have lost so much through the stupidity of war and through the ravages of what we see in sinful man. You don't cause the wars, Lord, but it's because we've come away from you that there are wars in this world, and difficulties and heartaches. It's not your fault, it's the fault of us who are sinful. And Lord, we do pray this morning, Lord, for those areas of our world that are suffering through starvation and deprivation, and for those children that have lost their mums and dads. And as we think of them this morning, Lord, we are far away from, we don't know all the circumstances of all these people. Maybe it would crush us if we did. But we can pray, Lord, above all else this morning that your gospel and the news of your grace might march forward mightily in this world, that those who don't know you will come to know you, that in the places of greatest desperation and need, that your love and your grace will reach down. And so, Father, this morning we come to you again and we ask your blessing upon our service and upon our Sunday school and the children in our congregation. We thank you for them, Lord, and for those who teach them Sunday by Sunday. We pray that your word might dwell in their hearts richly and that it might bring forth fruit in their lives. I thank you, Lord, that we know that when we sow seed, it may be in later years that that seed springs up and brings a harvest. But Lord, we know that children never forget what they've been taught in Sunday school. We may think they do, but they don't. And we know, Lord, that they carry these things with them into their adult lives. And so this morning, Lord, we give you thanks again for our fellowship together. Bless us this morning with your love, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Say the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
sing our first hymn now this morning, which is number 109.
Thank you.
suffering, as we remember, give thanks to God for everything that we have, and we do it this morning as an act of our worship. Which brought great revival to this nation and probably even stopped the French Revolution coming to this country as a result of it. And Lord, in our day we pray that there might be a turning away, that people in our nation might see the spiritual need of you and all the opposition that there is in our world to the gospel will be quelled by the power of your grace and your love. And Lord, our greatest need as a nation is for you. Our greatest need for the world is you. And we pray for all the missionaries in other countries who have taken your gospel to hostile societies often, particularly those who work in Islamic countries, in countries like even in North Korea, where there's so very, very few missionaries able to go in there. Well, they can't go in as missionaries, but helping in whatever way they can and maybe doing their small bit. We pray for those nations, Lord, that are so bound by dictatorships, so much so that they can hardly breathe because of fear of persecution and death. We cannot this morning imagine what it's like to live in a society like North Korea, where the world is almost worshipping one man. The need is truly great in our world, but it's your world, Lord. As we read last Sunday, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And we know, Lord, that you will ultimately be vindicated in this world one way or the other. But we pray that you might be vindicated by the outpouring of your grace among these needy people, that in those lands that know so little of you or of God, that, Lord, you will work mightily. And so this morning, Lord, we pray also that as we come around your word this morning, that you will make your word relevant to our own hearts and lives. That, Lord, we shall get a glimpse through your Holy Spirit of your love for us and of your greatness and what you are able to do. And so this morning we commit our service to you, asking for your blessing upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You'll now sing before I bring the message to you in number 50. Number 50.
Thank you.
chapter 3, we're just going to read that short chapter. That's Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah. A voice of one calling in the desert, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt round his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey, and the people went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. For the axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, and his winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." In John chapter 1, verse 29, it says there, "The next day John sees Jesus coming unto him and said, 'Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world.'" And the title of my message this morning is "Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Remover of Sin." And so this morning we are going to consider briefly the ministry of John the Baptist and the message that John the Baptist was preaching in his own day and generation is just as important to us today as it was to the people to whom he preached so many years ago. The people of John the Baptist's generation evidenced the first coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, Jesus already come, he died, he rose again and he ascended back to heaven. But we now live in anticipation of his second coming. Jesus assured his disciples before he went back to the Father that in like manner he would come, and they saw him go up into heaven, and he said, "You men of Galilee, why are you standing gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus will come as you have seen him go." So we live today in the anticipation of the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the words of John the Baptist that he preached to the people in the wilderness of Judea, to the people of his generation, are just as relevant to us today. So that as his words prepared the people for his first coming, that they may also speak in the same way to us today to prepare us for his second coming. It's very sad to me that the second coming of Jesus is not preached about half enough in our churches, and it should be in the forefront of our minds all the time that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming again. Now, I just want us to take this morning a quick look at the ministry of John the Baptist, and particularly also his character. First of all, it was prophesied in the Old Testament that John the Baptist would come. I read it this morning from Isaiah chapter 40. That prophecy was fulfilled exactly in the ministry of John the Baptist, many years before he came into the world. It was prophesied what he would do and where he would preach. In other words, he would be the herald, or the proclaimer, if you will, that the Messiah was about to make his appearance. Now, Jesus was already in the world, of course. We know how John the Baptist, about his birth and the birth of Jesus, they were there at the same time. He was already in the world when John the Baptist was preaching. Now, John the Baptist was, I think we could call him, a standalone character to the people of his day. I think this is demonstrated in his dress. It says he wore a tunic of camel's hair with a belt around his waist, and his diet was locusts and wild honey, and it was pretty obvious that he was a pretty fiery character. When we read what he said to the Pharisees in this chapter, I don't think if he was here today we'd invite him to preach. I don't think we would. In fact, I'm sure we wouldn't. A lot of churches, a lot of the people in John the Baptist's day, I suppose you could call him an eccentric in many ways, I suppose, but nevertheless he was a man of God. But to look at him, you wouldn't want him standing in your pulpit. And in actual fact, it's very interesting people thought he was Elijah. Some people thought that he was Elijah who had come back, because Elijah went up to heaven, we read, in a chariot of fire. But he denied, of course, that he was. And some even thought that he was the Messiah himself. He was such a fiery and a very persuasive preacher. Incidentally, there's something very interesting about his diet that I will tell you. He ate locusts and wild honey. Well, I did a bit of research on this, and I'll tell you what I found out. Did you know that locusts have got 40% protein, 43% fat, 13% fibre? They also contain omega-3 oils, zinc and calcium. Not a bad diet for nothing, is it? Mate, you want to come for dinner today? But that's an amazing diet, isn't it? So the diet of John the Baptist was very nutritious. And it didn't cost him anything. I thought he might have got stung out in the wild, didn't he? I don't know. But there were, that was his diet. You wouldn't call him a materialist, would you, by any shape or form? He was a fiery character, for sure. And he only had one message. The only reason why he was sent to preach was he called people to repentance. And that word repentance means initially to change your mind. Some people think to be repentant means to be sorry. Well, it may include that, but it really means, in actual fact, to change your mind about something. And people who have no time for God, to repent means they've got to change their mind about things initially, knowing that the coming Messiah would be the restorer of the nation. That's why he called people to repent, because he knew that the coming Messiah would be the restorer of the nation, and that he would purge away all that was evil and destructive, particularly regards to the religious leaders of his day. Jesus had a lot of trouble with the Pharisees, with the religious leaders of the day. They were the people who had no time for him whatsoever, really. Sad when you think about it, they were the leaders of the Jewish church, the Jewish community, and yet they had really no time for John the Baptist. But he was obviously a man who preached with great power and great conviction, and he brought his hearers face to face with decisions regarding their own lives. So they were prepared for the full force of the coming of Jesus. And the Bible tells us that John was a man filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. Right before he was ever born, he was filled with the Holy Spirit. He had a mission and he had a message, and that was to bring the people to repentance. Interesting thing, he never preached in the Jewish synagogues or in the temple precincts like Jesus did. He preached in the desert, in the same place where the children of Israel journeyed years before in Moses' day. That was where he preached. If you wanted to hear John the Baptist, you had to go out into a dry and a dusty wilderness to listen to him. But there were lots of people went out into the wilderness to hear him. As I said, I doubt there would be many churches who would invite him into their pulpits today. As I say, some people said he was demon-possessed, but they accused Jesus of being demon-possessed as well. Very sad, isn't it, when you have such a godly man that people say such things about. But his message speaks to us today. As we considered last week when we looked at God's controversy with the nations. But why was John the Baptist's ministry so well received by many people in Israel, which it was, in spite of his character, in spite of the kind of fiery person that he was? Why was his ministry so well accepted? Well, I believe it was for this reason. You see, the Israelites were a proud nation. God had given to them many, many years before the land of Canaan, through Joshua, of course, and through Moses. They had overcome their enemies and driven out those nations that worshipped idols. God promised the land of Canaan to Abraham many years that he would give them this land. And that was fulfilled through the ministry of Moses, who led his people through the wilderness, and through Joshua, who led them into the promised land. And they remember that the nation of Israel had been slaves in Egypt for 400 years. 400 years the nation of Israel had been in captivity in Egypt. That's a long time. And they cried out to God for deliverance. And God sent them Moses, who God spoke to through a burning bush, and sent him, but he went reluctantly to deliver his people from the hand of the Egyptians and from Pharaoh. And God did many miracles in Egypt in order to convince Pharaoh that God, the God of Israel, was truly God. And God did great things with that nation, which they could never have accomplished but for God's help. And God also sent them prophets to warn and to exhort them, but they failed to listen to the prophets. But instead, they killed the prophets with the sword. And so when eventually, when the nation of Israel fell into idolatry, which it did, it began to worship the gods of the nations around them, which God had distinctly forbidden them to do. They began to worship heathen gods. Then God warned them through the prophets that he would send them into exile in Babylon for 70 years. They didn't like what the prophets was telling them. They thought they were traitors, and they killed some of the prophets. And Jeremiah, as I said last week, they put him in prison because they were prophesying things they didn't want to hear. And so the prophets had a bad time. They never listened, and yet they were faithful in proclaiming the word of God, as we have to be faithful in sometimes we preach things that people are not too comfortable with. But these are not the words that I'm speaking this morning. This is the word of God, not what I think. It's what God has revealed to us through his word, and that we have to be faithful to in preaching the word of God. And so what happened was, the Babylonians came and destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. They sacked it. They ruined the city. And they took many, many people of the Jews captive. And there they were for 70 years. And the prophet Daniel was one of them, as was Jeremiah. And so then, when we come to the time of Jesus, the Jewish nation was subjugated to Rome. Rome had overtaken the Jews, and they were holding all the political power, and the Jews hated it. They hated that the Romans had taken over their country, which they believed it, God had given it to them, and they hated it. And the Jews are still very possessive of the land in which they live. And so the only hope that the Jews had was in their anticipation that the Messiah would come and would overthrow their enemies, which was Rome in that case, and restore the kingdom again. So when John the Baptist was there preaching that the Messiah had come, they were all agog. Oh good, we're going to get our nation back. It's almost the same if Hitler had conquered this country and we'd been subjugated by Nazism. We would have felt the same. Any message that spoke of that deliverance we would have received, and the Jews were like that. So they went out into the wilderness to listen to this man. Of course, the ministry of Jesus didn't turn out exactly as they had anticipated it. So not only had the Jews killed the prophets, but they killed Jesus as well. They killed the Son of God, the creator of the universe. They created and destroyed their Messiah. Isn't it amazing? The horror of human nature. They killed the best man who has ever walked on the face of this earth. Called him demon-possessed. They tried to kill him on many occasions because he spoke the truth. He spoke the truth. You know, there is a saying called the truth hurts. But there's nothing wrong with the truth. Sometimes the truth has to hurt us. But if it's the truth, we'd better listen to it. When Jesus was standing before Pontius Pilate, he says, "He who is of the truth, hears me." And Pilate sarcastically said to Jesus, "What is truth? What is truth?" Sarcasm. Jesus said, "He who is of the truth, listens to me. Listens to me." So those who took seriously the ministry of John the Baptist were surely those who would have accepted the ministry of Jesus the Messiah when he began to preach in the cities of Judah. John had many followers who took him seriously, and of course many of those followers, their hearts were prepared for the coming of Jesus, and they would have listened to him gladly, and that many, many people did. What we must realise, though, is that when John the Baptist was preaching about the coming Messiah, we must realise that John the Baptist would not realise the full scope of the ministry of Jesus and how the death of Jesus would fulfil his divine mission. I don't think John had it in his mind at all that Jesus was going to be crucified. I don't think he really connected with that. As far as he was concerned, the Messiah was here. And he was here for a job. He was here to deliver his nation, as Moses had delivered them years before from the hand of the Romans. And when John said those words, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world," yes, the Jews used to offer lambs for sacrifice, for taking away sin, but John probably had other things in mind, that Jesus would take away the sin of the world by his judgment upon the world and upon those who didn't repent of their sin. And there was a time in the ministry of John where he himself doubted whether Jesus was really the Messiah. And he sent two of his disciples to Jesus to ask him. And this is what he said, "And John called unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or are we looking for somebody else? When the men were come unto him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for someone else? And in that same hour, he cured many of their infirmities and plagues, and of evil spirits known to many that were blind, he gave sight. And Jesus answering these men who had come from John the Baptist, he said unto them, Go your way and tell John what things you have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and to the poor the gospel is preached. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. So they went back to tell John what they'd seen. And John would have immediately connected with the scripture in the Old Testament, which was prophesied of Jesus and his ministry in Isaiah 35, where it says, speaking of the ministry of Jesus, all these are living prophecies that were fulfilled. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And so Jesus, John the Baptist, when he saw Jesus coming towards him at his baptism, he says, behold, this is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. And John the Baptist would interpret that as well as judgment, as well as forgiveness. When we'll come back to what I said a little bit last week in my sermon about the enigma of the wrath of the Lamb. A lamb is such an innocent thing. You wouldn't look at a lamb and say, you'd be frightened of a lion, you'd be frightened of a lamb, would you? You might be frightened of a tiger, a bear, but to fear the wrath of a lamb, as I said, it doesn't make sense, the wrath of the Lamb. But listen to what John the Baptist says here in this third chapter when he was preaching in the wilderness. He says, Jesus will purge his flora. It says here, Jesus will purge his flora with his winnowing fork in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering the wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And so Jesus, John was telling these people that the appearing of Jesus would be connected with judgment as well as salvation. Well, it wasn't connected with judgment at that point. Jesus did not come into the world to judge the world at that time. He came into this world to be a saviour, to offer his life a living sacrifice for you and I. And so there is an enigma, but there is a day coming when God will come to judge this world. He will be the inexorable judge to whom every man must give an account. But we live today in a day of grace. The hand of grace and love is extended to those who put their faith and trust in Jesus. But there is one thing that God is committed to do and will do, and all the prophecies of the Old Testament testify to this. These are not my words. That Jesus will rid this world of sin and make it a good place to live. And he does that through either judging it, as we said last week when we read Isaiah chapter 24 there, or he can do it by taking upon himself the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. And so in that chapter that we read from Isaiah 40, God is speaking words of comfort to the people. Comfort ye, my people. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, and that her iniquity is pardoned. So in spite of what Israel had done in worshipping idols, he brought them back from exile, and he says, your iniquity is pardoned, because you have received of the Lord double for all your sins. I just want to have a little aside here, something that's very interesting. One of the things, it says in the Bible that every jot and tittle, every word, in other words, in the Bible, has relevance and meaning. Every small thing. Now, there's a very interesting thing that happened at the when Jesus rose again from the dead. And it was this. When Peter went into the tomb, he saw the grave clothes there, but the napkin that covered his face was folded up. Have you any idea why that napkin was folded up? you can easily miss things like this, you know, but it's very interesting. And it's for this reason. In Isaiah, it says, the Lord, that the nation of Israel, had received double for all their sins. Now, the interesting thing is this. Jesus, on the cross, paid the price for our sins. He received double trouble in order to save us. And the napkin was folded, I believe, to testify that now he had died and risen again from the dead, that he had atoned for our sins, and that napkin showed that he had received in his body the punishment for those who would put their faith in him. To me, that is wonderful when we think about it, that Jesus died on the cross in order to take the justice of God had to be satisfied, and God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And that's the most wonderful thing to me. You see, God is a God of mercy, he's a God of love, he's a God of justice, but he's a merciful God to those who will put their trust in him. And so, what is the application of this? What does this mean to us, each one? Well, the purpose of Jesus coming into the world was to redeem us and to turn us back to God. He did not come into this world to judge the world. When he was here in the world, he was not in the world to judge it. He was here to save it through his death on the cross. The first time he came as a saviour, and he is still a saviour to those who put their trust in him. He has rescued us from the judgment that will fall upon those who despised him and who failed to put their trust in his redeeming blood. Behold the Lamb of God, John says, that taketh away the sin of the world. Let me say this wholeheartedly this morning. I am not fit in any shape or form to stand in this pulpit this morning and preach to you. I am not. And neither are any of us. We are what we are. We preach this message only because of the grace of God and the love of God to each one of us. We are, all of us, unclean in God's sight. But Jesus came to take away our uncleanness, and he came to wash us in his precious blood. And that is the wonderful gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is our only hope. I hope we can grasp this. If we do not grasp this, we miss the most wonderful thing in all the world, that Jesus is our only hope of eternal life. And he's the only hope of our future happiness. And he endured all that to give us the joy and the knowledge through the Holy Spirit that our sins are forgiven. It's almost like the Queen of England saying to me, come with me, Eric, and live in the House of Windsor. So you'll never need to want for anything again, just come and live with me. It will never happen. But that's what God has done for us. He's given us the gift of eternal life. He said to us, look, come to me and I will give you rest. Come to me and I will give you eternal life. Come to me. And you've got a blessed hope of love and joy in the future. What a future we have to look forward to if we belong to Christ. Heaven is a place of great blessing. It's a place where we would want to be forever. Jesus said, in my presence is fullness. The David says, in thy presence is fullness of joy, and at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. But this only comes about by his grace when we trust him. This unconditional love that we could never earn, but God gives it to us freely. Let me ask you this question, as I ask it to myself, certainly. If Christ should come today or tomorrow, whether he takes us by death or whether he takes us when he comes, are we ready to receive him? And above all, would he own us? Would he own us? This is a question we must answer in our own hearts. Have we repented of our sins? Have we asked God's forgiveness through Christ? That's why Jesus came, to give us the hope of eternal life, not to send us to a lost eternity, but to give us everlasting life and the hope of something wonderful. Wouldn't it be wonderful to live in a world where there was no wars? Wouldn't it be wonderful? I can remember VE Day, and some of you here can probably remember VE Day and VJ Day. They're all having passes in the street that the war was over. It's finished, it's gone. Hitler's gone, he's dead. And there's a day coming when this world will be put to rights and Christ will reign supreme in this world. What a day of rejoicing that will be. But it begins now when we put our faith and our trust in us. And the only reason why I stand in this pulpit this morning is because of this message of salvation which I love to preach, which is a thing that brings us great joy. And we don't have to do anything for it. You haven't got to go and give your body to be burned or give all your money to the poor even. Nothing we have to do is only believe. And if we believe, we will find that God is all that he says he is. I'll never forget the day that I became a Christian. I was a church goer. I went to Corn Parish Church, sang in the choir, ring the bell, did everything. You know what I mean? The day that I became a Christian, when I went out of that house, I felt that if somebody had fired a gun at me, the bullets would have bounced off. I know it's a strange thing to say, but it's true. It was so wonderful. And that experience, we may not experience just like I did, but everybody, God deals with different people in different ways, of course he does. But all I'm saying is this, that salvation is a wonderful thing when we embrace it. So I'll say no more, I think you've got the message that this is what we've been talking about, that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Let's pray. And so our gracious God this morning, we thank and praise you for your word. There is so much in it that exceeds our human expectations or even sometimes challenges our intellectual thinking. But we know your word is truth because all the things that we have spoken about this morning have been fulfilled or will be fulfilled in the future. We can trust the Bible because everything in it has been exactly as you have said. And the things that you said about the future we know will also come true because it's your precious word. Give us that necessary faith. Help us, Lord, to overcome our intellectualism sometimes, which can stand in the way, and sometimes our pride that could stop us from coming and believing these things, that we might know the joy of sins forgiven and the hope of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you for this gospel, Lord, this morning we pray. Your word be in our hearts as we leave this place this morning. Amen. Amen. Right, we'll sing our closing hymn then, number 178. I don't know this hymn myself, but maybe some others here do.
Oh,
you for choosing that, Frank, very appropriate. And we've been talking about the gospel at the Sunday school.
I'm not saying.
Pardon?
They're not coming.
Okay, fine. Right then. Well, let's say the grace together then. May the grace of
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, forevermore.